Good afternoon. The first item of business is topical questions. In order to get as many members in as possible, I'd be grateful for short and succinct questions and responses. And at question number one, I call Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what analysis it has carried out regarding the implementation and potential impact of short-term lets legislation.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robison.
So in December 2020, we published six different impact assessments. These and a separate business regulatory impact assessment were informed by evidence and information from partners and stakeholders and set out analysis on the likely costs, risks and benefits of short let sector regulation. We'll continue to work with local authorities and in the summer of 2023 we'll review levels of short-term let activity in hotspot areas to assess how the actions we're taking are working and ensure that there are no unintended consequences.
Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I know that the Cabinet Secretary is acutely aware of the concerns being expressed, especially by Class 7 guest houses and bed and breakfasts, which have been included in the scheme by some councils, which should have been excluded, and indeed many councils not even having in place the teams to do this work. Like many small businesses, short-term lets are still to recover very much so from the COVID pandemic. The Scottish Association of Self-Caterers have warned that the Scottish Government's legislation will negatively impact on the sector and are now calling for the implementation of this legislation to be delayed. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, with this in mind, will she agree to delaying this legislation and take on board these growing concerns on the negative impact this will have?
Cabinet Secretary.
So let me try and deal with all of these points. On the first issue of delay calls, we've introduced, as a member knows, licensing to first and foremost ensure that there are mandatory safety standards for short-term lets across Scotland. And of course, it also provides local authorities with the powers to introduce additional licensing conditions to address issues that are of concern to their local area. As a member will also know, many short-term lets already comply with these conditions, and for those that don't, it is important that these are in place as soon as possible to ensure a level playing field and safety across Scotland. There is a transition period for existing operators, and they have until the 1st of April 2023 to apply for a licence and may continue to operate while their licence is being determined. Miles Briggs mentioned the issue of guest houses specifically, which I am happy to deal with because I think it's important for clarity here. The Civic Government Scotland Act 1982 Order 2022 does not reference planning use classes. Schedule 1 lists excluded accommodation, which includes hotels with planning permission granted for use as a hotel, but it doesn't list guest houses with planning permission granted for use as a guest house as an exclusion. Therefore, to be clear, unless otherwise excluded by any of the criteria set out in Schedule 1 of the licensing order, short-term let accommodation will require a license to operate, and this includes guest houses. Now, we've been clear about that for quite some time, and certainly since June 2021, so I would hope there would be no misunderstanding there. And on the issue of promotion, we will be ensuring that there is a campaign running from October, which again will make information in the public domain very clear indeed. And of course, we have I have written to local authority housing conveners and chief executives to remind them of their duty to establish short-term licensing schemes by the 1st of October this year.
Miles Briggs.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, but I think it is a complacent one in the sense of the inconsistencies which we are seeing across local authorities in the implementation of this government legislation. And the Deputy First Minister, for example, has been telling guest houses in his own constituency that they are exempt. So I think the Scottish Government clearly are not giving the right information as well to constituents, to businesses. And what is clear, I think, from what the Cabinet Secretary said today, is this does need a bit of time to properly work and to be bedded in. So can I go back to the key point which I asked, is does she not now realise that this legislation is a mess and needs to have a pause for councils to properly implement it, especially given many haven't even employed the staff yet who will be tasked with doing this?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, first of all, I don't accept that description of this legislation. We have had numerous consultations on this legislation. Parliament has had ample time to scrutinise it. There has been widespread consultation with stakeholders and stakeholder input into the stakeholder implementation group. The member mentioned inconsistencies. During this year, we've worked with the Scottish Housing Network and officials from across all local authorities to plan for implementation of the licensing scheme. And this has involved discussing different local approaches to understand the rationale and facilitate common processes where possible to do so. So there will be some circumstances where, as I gave in my answer earlier, there will be local variation because of local need. But we've tried where possible to ensure that there's common processes and that there's simple online information and application processes that should be straightforward for applicants to follow.
Paul McLennan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. During the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee scrutiny of the short-term lets licensing scheme, most councils expressed support or enthusiasm for the plans, especially those with tourist hotspots. With these new measures, does the Cabinet Secretary believe that councils will feel more empowered to balance tourism with the needs of their local communities?
Cabinet Secretary.
I do agree with that. Local communities have told us over a number of years about their safety concerns and the impact that the concentration of lets, short-term lets, can have on communities and the availability of housing. Regulation of short-term lets is appropriate for the whole of Scotland and offers considerable flexibility to local authorities on how it's implemented. And licensing will, of course, allow councils and communities to take action to manage issues more effectively without unduly curtailing some of the benefits of short-term lets to host visitors and the Scottish economy. But we need to ensure that they are safe and providing them are suitable and fit and proper people to do so, and I'm surprised that anyone could disagree with that.
Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I refer members to my register of interest? Cabinet Secretary, while we've waited for the SNP government to act on short-term lets, thousands of homes were lost in Edinburgh. But Labour-led Edinburgh Council have now implemented the new rules as quickly as possible, but over £3 million was lost to the public purse in Edinburgh in the last financial year alone because of the loophole that still exists where short-term let owners can move to business rates and then receive the 100% small business bonus scheme discount. So given that the Scottish Government committed years ago to reviewing the tax treatment of short-term lets, what progress has been made on that review and when will that review be completed?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, you know, I think Sarah Boyack, in the interest of fairness, would possibly recognise that a lot of the groundwork was actually done under the previous administration in Edinburgh, completed under the current administration. And I think anyone giving a fair analysis would recognise that. And we, of course, were happy to give ministerial approval to the order that had been brought after proper due consultation, which of course was welcomed as part of the short-term let control area that local authorities had to consult with their communities. And of course that takes time, but it's the right thing to do. And if we hadn't put that in, I'm sure people in this chamber would be raising concerns about the lack of consultation locally. So I think that's the right balance and it's important to get it right. On the issue of taxation, we have taken steps to ensure that self-catering properties are correctly classified on the valuation roll for non-domestic rates tax purposes. From the 1st of April 2022, premises are now required to be actually let for a period of at least 70 days and available for let for 140 days in the same financial year in order to be classed as self-catering. And that will go some way to addressing some of the loopholes that Sarah Boyack was referring to. But I'm happy to give her any further information that she would find helpful in that regard.
Question number two, Katie Clark.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will make a statement on the policing and arrests at events connected to the death of the Queen and the proclamation of a new monarch.
Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown.
I'd like to pay tribute to Police Scotland for their considerable efforts in the planning and delivery of Operation Unicorn, an operation in scale, complexity and sensitivity without precedent. It is, though, the fundamental right of anyone living in a democracy to peacefully protest. As demonstrated during COP26, Police Scotland protect people's right to protest whilst balancing the rights of the wider community and upholding public safety. The member will appreciate that operational decisions are a matter for the Chief Constable, with scrutiny and oversight provided by the Scottish Police Authority, and it's not appropriate for me to comment on specific cases. And any complaint about the actions of officers should be made directly to Police Scotland in the first instance.
Katie Clark.
Thank you. And I recognise that it was a huge policing operation, but media reports suggest heavy-handed policing, with 4 arrests for breach of the peace, a number of others detained and then released without charge, and a woman who was demonstrating about free speech followed by police officers. What discussions has the Cabinet Secretary had with Police Scotland about these incidents?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think I've just said, President Officer, that I am not able to comment on individual cases, but I do confirm that Police Scotland do approach their job firmly on the basis of human rights legislation and operate, of course, under the principle of policing by consent. They have confirmed that there will be a formal debrief process for Operation Unicorn, and I understand that Operation Unicorn will be discussed at the Scottish Police Authority Board later this month, the appropriate forum for doing that. I also understand this will include reviewing at least one of the incidents that took place while the operation was active. I'm meeting with the Chief Constable tomorrow and will discuss these issues with him with a view to looking at, as ever, what lessons can we learn from the operation and how these can be applied to future policing operations. I will also congratulate him and his force on a superb job, notwithstanding the issues which have been raised by the member.
Katie Clark.
Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that these incidents create a worrying precedent and that freedom of speech is a fundamental right? So I'm grateful that he's going to discuss these issues with Police Scotland tomorrow, but would he ensure that MSPs get the opportunity to discuss these issues and our approach on policy on these issues?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think I've just confirmed that the right to peaceful and democratic process is one which we fully support and Police Scotland do support as well. There are quite a number of ways in which individual members can, of course, make their views known to the Chief Constable or to the SPA, but if there are particular methods that are being proposed by the member for doing that, I'm more than happy to meet with the member and discuss those further. But the police will be very open. They are accountable in many different ways, very open to receiving representations, as a member will know, from MSPs.
Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I share the member's concerns about some aspects of policing during the proclamation and later during the funeral procession on the Royal Mile. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to confirm? I understand there are many different police forces on duty then, and just to confirm that Police Scotland had overall control and operational policy control, and if so, and I note what the Cabinet Secretary says about the debriefing and the review, will the outcome of that review be made public, or certainly could you ask the police SPA if that can be done?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I should say for the members' information, Presiding Officer, that whenever constables or police officers from other jurisdictions come to serve and help under mutual aid arrangements with Police Scotland, control always rests with the Chief Constable and, of course, the Lord Advocate as well. And similarly, we had 1,000 police officers in London and throughout England and Wales to help with events down in that area this week, and they at that time will be under the control of local police chiefs. So that's the way it should be done, and of course in Scotland it will always be the Chief Constable that's in control. Just to say, it will be up to the Scottish Police Authority how the discussions that they have with the Chief Constable are discussed and the extent to which they are made public. The Chief Constable will provide an update on the policing activities that supported the operation, and I've already mentioned the extent to which that will be subject to review, but it will be for the SPA to make those decisions.
Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Despite the mammoth scale of the events, there clearly were a number of small isolated incidents, which no doubt will be further to due scrutiny. But would the Justice Secretary agree with me that on the whole, Police Scotland did a tremendous job and should be thanked for their efforts? Officers rank and file from right across Scotland supported events here in Edinburgh and in London, but not just them, the Army of Volunteers and their armed forces who behaved impeccably over the last week.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'll say first of all, that is certainly true. It does not mean that the issues which are raised by other members are not significant and important and should be considered. But I think the member is exactly right, and just probably wrongly, to give one example of that the police officer, I think it was a superintendent, who drove the motorbike from Balmoral for 6 hours at very low speed, and then was confronted with the Royal Mile and the cobbled stones to come down there under control, shows you the level of concentration and ability and expertise that there is within Police Scotland. I think they did a tremendous job, although, as I've said, that does not mean we shouldn't explore other issues which have arisen.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In her coronation address, Her Late Majesty professed a belief in free speech and tolerance. She called it a precious part of our way of life, and she asked the British people to cherish it and to practice it. Free speech and the right to peaceful protest are the cornerstones of this liberal democracy, even when we find them distasteful or inappropriate. I am concerned that the Cabinet Secretary has stressed that he won't speak to specific examples of policing. Surely policing by consent means that activities of Police Scotland should be accountable to this Parliament. And if he won't talk to specific events, in what forum can these concerns be voiced by members of this Parliament?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think I've already said two or three times that I fully support the right to democratic and peaceful protest. And I think it's also true, as Jamie Green pointed out, the number of arrests which happened here are very, very small compared to the scale of the event which took place. Nevertheless, there are serious issues. But I'll just say to Alec Cole-Hamilton, check the legislation. I'm not allowed to involve myself because a decision of this Parliament in 2012 explicitly rejected the idea that ministers or the Parliament would directly control the police. I'm not allowed to do that under that legislation. So perhaps he could familiarise himself with that legislation before he asks his next question.
Maggie Chapman.
We've heard much about the arrests of people who expressed anti-imperialist or anti-monarchy views, holding signs, carrying eggs. What we've heard less about are the people, mostly young women, who were followed, and those who were held by police had their details taken simply for booing or being near people with anti-monarchy signs. Does the Cabinet Secretary believe this behaviour, which has felt threatening and intimidating, is acceptable, especially given that similar concerns were raised less than a year ago during and after COP26?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think, first of all, my views on the policing of COP26 are on the record. But as I've said in my original answer, and I have to repeat, it's not appropriate for me to comment on the detail of specific cases, although I do understand that Police Scotland are aware of the incident which the member has mentioned, shared via social media, and that the content of the footage, that video footage, is currently being reviewed. However, I do want to underline our commitment to having strong systems and processes in place for dealing with complaints against the police, and we outlined in the programme for government our intention to introduce a bill on police complaints and misconduct handling later this parliamentary year.
Question number three, Mark Ruskell.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is regarding the impact in Scotland of the reported plans of the UK Government to grant up to 130 new oil and gas exploration licences.
Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson.
Oil and gas exploration and production, including licensing, remains reserved to the UK Government. The Scottish Government is clear unlimited extraction of fossil fuels is not consistent with our climate obligations if we are to meet our target of 1.5 degrees under the Paris Agreement, and it is not the right solution to the real cost of living crisis families are facing. Instead of licensing more fossil fuel extraction, the UK Government should be encouraging investment in renewables and supporting a just transition for our energy sector, Scottish households and businesses.
Mark Ruskell.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. In her first weeks in Downing Street, Liz Truss has taken a wrecking ball to climate commitments. The UK Government is once again pretending that they can drill their way out of the energy crisis while the world is facing unimaginable suffering from climate breakdown. From installing a fossil fuel fanatic as her energy secretary to making no reference to climate in her first speech on energy policy, this is climate denial at its worst. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, does he agree that the development of the Rosebank oil field alongside Cambo and Jackdaw undermines both the Paris Agreement and the Glasgow Pact and will do nothing to reduce energy bills that people are currently facing?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I think if we look at the focus at the present moment on trying to tackle the cost of living crisis that many households are facing as a result of increasing energy costs, increasing extraction of oil and gas within the North Sea will not address that issue. That's not my view, that's a view of the UK Government. Kwasi Kwarteng, the former Energy Secretary of the UK Government, now the Chancellor of the Exchequer, made that point himself during the course of the debate in the House of Commons earlier this year. And that's why, if we are to try to tackle the underlying causes that are driving household energy bills and non-domestic energy bills at the present moment, the way in which to do that is to decarbonise our energy system and to reduce our dependency on fossil fuels. And in doing that, we reduce our potential risk to the malign forces of people like Putin in the future. That's why renewable energy is the most effective way in which to do that, not only in delivering cheaper energy for domestic and non-domestic users, but also it delivers energy security, an approach which we can benefit from here in Scotland, specifically with an acceleration of renewable energy projects.
Mark Gruskell.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response as well. Yesterday, the UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres called on countries to tax the windfall profits of oil and gas companies to support people struggling with the cost crisis, but also to support communities who are suffering immense loss and damage from climate change around the world. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with his proposal?
Cabinet Secretary.
Sir, officer, at a time when households are facing such high energy bills, which are driving quite literally millions of households into fuel poverty and extreme fuel poverty, the focus is not only the need to make sure that we do everything we can to reduce the financial burden it has on them here and now, but also to prevent burdening households with increased fuel costs in the future. And that is the real risk of the approach that's been taken by the UK government in the announcement they've made to date in tackling this cost of living crisis. The focus, I believe, should be on taxing the windfall profits of those particularly energy companies that are making sizeable profits and using that money to offset the costs on households. Now, it's estimated that these companies will make in the region of £170 billion over the course of the next 2 years alone. That form of a windfall tax could be used to offset the costs of energy prices in people's homes today. And the UK government should do that as opposed to burdening the additional costs onto household bills, which is what will happen in the future with the approach they've taken.
Fiona Hislop.
Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that the UK Prime Minister should heed Alex Sharmer, former UK-based Secretary of State and COP26 President, who stated, climate and environmental security are now synonymous with energy and national security, and that Scotland's great asset of a combined energy sector means that sensible use of existing domestic oil and gas licences subject to climate analysis during the energy transition and investment in renewable energy growth, including green hydrogen exports, will provide more energy security to ourselves and our European partners who desperately want green energy supply security from hostile actors than the UK government agreeing 130 new but long-term licences without climate impact analysis.
Cabinet Secretary.
I do agree with the President of COP26, Alex Sharmer, because he also stated countries now understand the benefits of low-cost, homegrown renewables, the price of which cannot be manipulated from afar, recognising that renewable energy is the quickest, cheapest, most environmentally friendly approach you can have to tackling our energy crisis at the present moment while delivering energy security. And Scotland is rich with the natural assets to deliver that, not just for our own domestic needs here in Scotland, for the rest of the UK, but also to help to support the decarbonisation of energy across other parts of Europe, whether it be in onshore, offshore wind, CCUS, battery storage, whether it be hydroelectric, all of which can contribute to our energy transition. And Scotland has the natural benefits to maximise these resources. That's why it's absolutely critical that we see from the UK government, it's early in this new government's days, but we see an approach that is consistent with the need to drive forward renewable energy to help to reduce energy costs overall.
Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Mark Ruskell strangely forgot to mention Guterres also saying fossil fuels cannot be shut down overnight. A just transition means leaving no person or country behind. Without new investment in fields like Cambo and Jackdaw, and indeed political support from the Scottish Government, production will fall off a cliff, jeopardising the just transition and the 90,000 Scottish jobs that will deliver it, and makes us reliant on environmentally worse imports from regimes like Putin's. So, Cabinet Secretary, has this government made an assessment of the financial, economic and environmental impacts of the Scottish Government's plans to abandon our oil and gas sector? And if so, will it be published?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, President Officer, let's try and deal with some of the facts, because we've been quite consistent in our approach, and that is that we should be transitioning away from our dependency on fossil fuels in order to reduce our risk of exposure to the malign forces such as Putin, an approach which is agreed by the UK government. The failure of the UK government is that they aren't actually driving forward the policies that will deliver on that as well. And that's the point that has been made here. They need to make sure that we ramp up our production of renewables and other forms of renewable resources, both on and offshore, in order to reduce our dependency on fossil fuels. Our oil and gas sector, as I have consistently said in this chamber, and I think possibly even to the member, will continue to play an important part in our economy going forward. But at the same time, we need to ramp up our renewable developments, and that will help to reduce our costs overall. And what I think is wrong, what I think is seriously wrong, is the impression that some try to give that by simply extracting some more oil and gas, we can in some way reduce our energy costs. The reality is that will not happen. And that's the impression the UK government have tried to give with the announcement over the course of the last few days. It simply will not work, because all the evidence demonstrates that will not deliver the type of output that's needed to do that.
Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The approach by the UK Government and the Scottish Conservatives is indeed worrying and wrong-headed, but can I ask the Cabinet Secretary about what the Scottish Government can do to make sure that our planning system in Scotland is robust and fit for purpose? Because if we are going to see offshore oil and gas, new developments like Cambo and Jackdaw and Rosebank coming forward, what can we do to make sure that our planning system is robust, because there will be a requirement for onshore assets and infrastructure? What can we do to frustrate the process if necessary?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Senior Officer, most of the licences which are issued nowadays are tie-backs into existing oil and gas infrastructure that comes on to onshore. So new fields have been brought on, tying into existing infrastructure to come onshore. So by and large, there are no planning provisions in this for Scottish ministers and the Scottish Government to be involved in. The licensing of exploration licences and also for production licences solely rests with the UK Government. I believe this should be here in this Parliament. We should be deciding these policies here in this Parliament, given the importance they have to our natural environment and to our fuel security in the future. But as it largely stands, when it comes to oil and gas production, very often there are no planning requirements for Scottish ministers to be involved in the process.